Good afternoon. It's my pleasure and privilege to be here at the talk. And it's always good to be with present amongst most of you innovators over here, because it's a unique opportunity for the government to see what is happening tomorrow, today itself. And more importantly, I can see that you had a very interesting dialogue and a talk with Ms. Lavanya. And I'm not sure if I can really do a better job than what she's done. That'll be a tough act to follow, I think. But nevertheless, more importantly, I see a lot of hungry faces. So, and the last thing you want to listen when you're hungry is to a politician. I know that. So anyway, I'll try to wrap it up as quickly as I can. So I always say that one of my favorite quotes from is from Socrates, and he says the secret of change is to focus all of your energy not on fighting the old but on building the new. And the government of Karnataka has always been focusing on building a bolder, better, and the most advanced ecosystem for its citizens to interpret, intervene, and interact with the government for the best possible delivery of governance for a better Karnataka, and that has propelled Karnataka and Bengaluru as the second largest technology hub in the world and is rated as the most dynamic city in the world by JLL at the World Economic Forum. And we've also been listed as the 13th best ecosystem for innovation and startups in the world, and we're the fourth most preferred destination for R&D by Fortune 500 companies, overtaking the cities of Shanghai, Chicago, and Tokyo. All this has happened by providing the most basic environment that is needed to foster innovation and invention, that is the environment for ideation. Probably we are the only state in the entire country that has ideation as a part of its policy. Because if there is no ideation, there cannot be innovation, there cannot be invention, and more importantly, there cannot be investments. So this is something that the government of Karnataka has understood pretty early, and we have incorporated this as a part of our policy itself. And this need of ideation is so very important, because that is what will foster innovation. Now, because I heard the compere speak about how more women entrepreneurs should be put into the ecosystem. Now, how can we put so many entrepreneurs, whether it's women or anybody else, into the ecosystem is only when you give a very conducive environment for ideation. Only when you encourage ideation is when you can have any innovation possible or entrepreneurship possible. And today, we can be proud of the fact that we have more than 7,200 startups here only in Bengaluru, and they're all looking at the government to seek some kind of guidance from them, and they're looking at us to take them to the next level. And we too, that is the government of Karnataka too, is trying to do our best to help them succeed, because today 95% of the startups today are failing, and we are trying to see how we can do our little bit to ensure their success. Because fostering innovation, fostering entrepreneurship, fostering innovation is a very difficult thing to do. And it is not that everybody can take this leap of faith. The private sector cannot do this. And the government is the only body that can, or the only institution that can actually do this kind of things. So firstly, in order to understand, the government needed to understand why startups fail in order to ensure that they foster innovation. Why is it important for government to understand that? Because if we do not understand why startups are failing, we cannot build an ecosystem for them to succeed. And probably there are plenty of reasons, but I would like to state a few of them here and what we are doing about it. Because I get to see a lot of startups, and each one of them are so passionate about it that they forget to evaluate the idea itself. You know, you will not believe me, I get startups at 8 a.m. in my house. I was telling Bala the other day, 8 a.m. in my house, they come with a presentation in a laptop saying, sir, you please see this startup idea that I have. It's the most disruptive idea in the vertical. And a lot of people think that the government money is in my house, which is not true. And nor do I keep money in my pockets. And more importantly, I'm not the expert at all to help you identify or validate the idea. But the point I'm trying to make here is that there are so many ideas that are floating around. There are so many people with great ideas. So what is? But they forget to evaluate. They forget to validate that idea because they're so immersed into it. First of all, when I sit through a lot of startups, I ask them, are they building a product or a service that anybody wants in the first place? Is it that something you want, or is it something that the ecosystem wants? They don't, because I see a lot of startups who do not do proper market analysis or market need analysis. And we need to, and we tell them that you need to build what a few people will really love and not something that million people might like. At the end of the day, million people might like what you have built, might like what you have done, but how many thousands of them actually use it? Because your revenue models, your idea validation, or your use case is going to come when people use it. That is something that we help them do, idea validation. And more importantly, I've seen some startups who, when given funds, I've seen it in my tenure itself, and I have, in the last 4 months itself, or 5 months itself, I have funded close to around 61 startups. And they spend recklessly. And I have seen that the first tranche gets over in 1 week and they come in for the second tranche. No milestones, even though there are milestones that have been set for them to do it, they spend recklessly. And maybe that is because of lack of mentorship. So we provide that mentorship, that the financial mentorship that is needed for them also. And they don't have a business plan or a model. The pricing will always be either too expensive because they are the only one, or they will be too cheap because they wouldn't have done the market analysis, like I said. And moreover, they would top it up with poor marketing, which makes them sell to the wrong audience. So I cannot, like, I heard somebody ask about saris, right? You need an audience to sell saris. I don't know if Ms. Lavanya is still around here. Are you? So. It was really good to see you, ma'am, and the way old economies are disrupting the new ones as well. It's a nice presentation where she gave about transcending, but you cannot sell a nulli to, in my constituency, it's too expensive. Until and unless you come back with me with some Bidkal sari or something like that, which is affordable. So the point I'm trying to make here, startups generally do that. They because they have lack of mentorship, of lack of guidance, they end up selling it to the wrong audience as well. Pricing is an issue. And I've also noticed that sometimes startups lose focus very easily. Their ideas keep changing. Every time they meet some great speaker, they change their goalposts. So every time they have a new milestone, I'm sure every time they hear Bala speak, they will be changing the milestone, or Mr. Vishwaswaran speak, they will be changing their milestone. Maybe this is the right one. So, and of course, when they meet the government, then it's a complete other thing. So, I've seen that happen a lot of times where people keep shifting goalposts, which makes it very difficult for them to succeed. And more importantly, I have seen that the startups don't have or have little access to legal help. So they don't know how to start a business. They don't know how to run a business legally. And if they know how to do both of them, and in case they don't succeed, they don't know how to shut down a business legally. That's very important. So recently, you know, there was this big hospitality industry aggregator who was in the dock in our neighboring state. And I think personally, with all the clout, with all the rock star image he had of a startup, he was legally ill-advised. So that is something that I noticed. People, startups do not take legal help. And so we are trying to address all these problems for you. The startup industry needs, the startup ecosystem needs these small things to be addressed. And so we started this startup cell under the Department of IT to help entrepreneurs on government policies. We have devised mechanisms wherein people can people can come on board the startup cell. That could be mentors, that could be accelerators, that could be business incubators, that could be for idea validation. So people, not every startup needs funding. A lot of people can get a lot of help only with idea validation. They can have transactional advisors from us. We give them networking opportunities, and we help them with customer acquisition. We give them seed funds. We give them access to 400 crores of venture funds within the government. We also help them access world-class VCs. We also send them for cross-border entrepreneurial networking opportunities. So this is what the government is trying to do for the ecosystem. So it is quite unlikely of any state government to do that, but here we are trying to stimulate the entire ecosystem. And we had this small program called Elevate 100 recently. It was an experimental program where we tried to see, where we tried to seek the top 100 innovations across the state. And for the first time, I went, the government went outside Bengaluru to seek for to seek innovation. You'll be quite surprised. In around less than 3 weeks, we had close to around 1,700 startups register with us, out of which close to 300 odd startups were women entrepreneurs, and more than 350 startups or innovators were from outside Bengaluru. So Mangaluru, Mysuru, Hubli, Bellari, Kalburgi, Raichur. So they were from all over Karnataka. And this is what is encouraging the government. So innovation is just not restricted to Bengaluru. We found out in our Elevate 100 that we have innovation outside Bengaluru also. And we reached out to them. We did not tell them to come to Bengaluru and give their presentations. We went to Kalburgi, we went to Belgaum, we went to Hubli. We had sessions like how we are having now. People got to show their presentation. So when was the last time you heard any government actually see your presentation or showcase your presentation to some of the best transactional advisors like PwC, KPMG, or probably Nexus Ventures, and the Indus Entrepreneurs? So you had people and panel experts, in the vertical experts, evaluating your presentations, evaluating these ideas. So you'll be quite surprised that this three-week exercise, when we identified 1,700, then we came down to 650, then we narrowed down to 300, which is a very difficult thing to do. And on the last day, in one single day, we had more than 300 startups being evaluated by industry experts, out of which we have narrowed down on close to 112 startups, although it was Elevate 100 because of a lot of people getting equal marks. We had to make it 112, they have recommended more than close to around 80-85 startups will be getting close to 35 crores rupees as grant from the government of Karnataka. That is phenomenal, and the rest will be, they have recommended. So the jury has recommended idea validation, probably a pilot with the government, or probably access to world-class mentors, maybe collaborations with private sector. So all these loose ends we will be tying up for them. So we too are trying to be as disruptive as possible, because we understand that technology is changing faster than ever before. And if we don't adopt to these, and if we are not going to be staying on top, then we'll never become a global player, especially in technology. And hence we are heavily concentrating on collaborations as well. Because right now, yes, we are number one in Bengaluru. Yes, we are probably the second best startup ecosystem in the world. But I want to get away from the tag of being a services industry. Although services industry does provide a lot of jobs, yes, that is the government's focus because it creates a lot of jobs. But we have to create innovators. We have to create entrepreneurs. And the government is looking at how to do this, how to stimulate this, not just with the startup cell. We're also collaborating for knowledge exchanges outside India. So we have a Bengaluru-Boston biotech corridor. We have a Silicon Valley corridor for innovation. We have a geriatrics and a cybersecurity corridor with Hague. We recently signed up for 5G, IoT, and IoT and broadband, probably, OFC with Finland. So we are trying to see how G2G exchanges also can help private sector. It's not that I'm going to go there for some networking opportunities or to learn this thing. The startups that are registered with us will be engaging with the academia or with the private sector over there. That is something, again, that no other country, no other state gives you. And more importantly, we talk about emerging technologies. Everywhere we talk about disruption, we talk about creative disruption, and we're trying to see how we can help with emerging technologies also. Like I said, we want to, I'm sure that many of you sitting over here don't want to be called as the back office operations of the world. We are tired of that tag, aren't we? So we need to be disruptive as well. So What are we doing to ensure that the government is doing to ensure that we stay on top of the game? But one is collaboration with academia and private sector and with the government abroad. But besides that, we are also trying to enhance our skill sets. So we are coming up with small, quick interventions with the centers of excellence. So we have centers of excellence. I've spent 288 crore to get a center of excellence in aerospace and space. By this month end, I'll have a center of excellence in big data, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. By next month end, I will have a center of excellence in cybersecurity and cyberspace. And I'm already running India's only center of excellence for IoT. So why am I doing this? So that we can have skill set ready workforce, because there is a lot of disruption happening. There is a lot of job losses happening because of automation, and there's nothing to fear about. There is a lot of opportunities in animation, gaming, cybersecurity, aerospace, AI, machine learning, and you need to be skill ready. And the government of Karnataka is focusing heavily to ensure that all of you are skill ready, so that once I give the knowledge part of it, then there is no looking back. Why is it that whenever I go to my road shows, I do not insist on investment? I insist on partnership. I insist saying that let us collaborate on knowledge. Because if I have skilled labor, if I have skill sets, if I have the knowledge base, if I have a knowledge society, investments will flow. So that's why I always insist on ideation, innovation, and invention. I have these three backed with a solid backing of skill sets at the bottom of the pyramid, investments will definitely flow. And we also do something interesting, because a lot of people keep asking, how can we work with the government? And when I came here, a lot of people ask me, whenever I go to forums like these, I get very little questions about the IT policy or the biotech policy. I get a lot of questions on the traffic, on infrastructure, on why metro is not connected to that place, so which is not my domain, which is the government's responsibility, but unfortunately or fortunately, I'm only the minister for IT. So, but nevertheless, we have something to solve these kind of problems. We have something called the grand challenges, problems that are plaguing government are thrown open to startups. So we have made 6 calls so far. One is about potability of water that is distilled in the municipal corporations. One is about malnutrition. And much more recently, we have launched about trying to solve Bengaluru's traffic woes. So if startups have a solution for it, they can enter through the grand challenges. So that is because they can enter through the grand challenges, number one, and if we like the idea, we adopt the idea, fund it, ensure there is a pilot, and if the pilot is successful, we ensure it's implemented the whole 9 yards as well. So that is something that, again, is quite disruptive that we do to engage with startups. Besides that, we are also looking at how to employ startups in the government sector. So especially in a lot of people want to want to work with the government. So government services is something that we are trying to see how we can bring in a policy that certain bit of government services are given to startups, or product procurement happens through startups. So that's a work in progress, and I'm sure if once we do that, we'll be able to help a lot more startups within the government, because I noticed this that during our previous tourism startup call out, there was a couple of startups who worked with us. I have 12 startups working only in the tourism sector. Overall, I think close to around 25 to 30 startups are working with the government right now in different departments. But the ones that are working in the tourism sector, one or two of them turned out really smart. We gave them a pilot, which they did. Of course, we paid them for it as well, if there are any doubts about government paying anyone. So we gave them the pilot, and they went to other departments of tourism in other states, and they showed, look here, the government of Karnataka has given us this order. They have validated this idea for us. Maybe you should try it too. And he has a couple of orders outside the state now. So that is the kind of disruption the government of Karnataka is also working on. So like I said earlier, we too are trying to be as creative and disruptive as the ecosystem is. And we are trying to encourage startups and to ensure they succeed. Because only if they succeed is when we succeed. If I have a policy, it's not going to be any good, because there's a saying that goes saying that the paper has a lot of patience. So whatever policy you put on it, whatever you put on it, stays on paper if you're not going to act on it. So government of Karnataka is not believing in ideas, but in making them happen. We believe just not in the ideas itself, but we believe strongly believe in making those ideas happen. And that's why probably we are the number one ecosystem in India today. So I would not, I don't want to take much of your time because like I said, there are a lot of hungry faces because there are another couple of pages I thought I should talk about, but I think I will take some Q&A if there is a Q&A. But I would like to conclude by quoting one of my favorite authors, that is George Bernard Shaw, who said that the reasonable man adapts himself to the world. The unreasonable one persists in trying to adapt the world to himself. Therefore, all progress depends on the unreasonable man. So I'm sure that a lot of startups that are sitting here are unreasonable people, but be rest assured that people like Bernard Shaw have evaluated that you are the ones who are going to change the future, because being an entrepreneur is a very difficult thing to do. It takes a lot of guts, it takes a lot of pain, and because everybody can talk about the change that they want to see, but entrepreneurs have dived deep to be the change. So that's a very difficult thing to do. An armchair thinker can say that is not good, this is not good, this might be probably done, but entrepreneurs are the strongest of the lot who are jumping right in and trying to be the change that they want to see. So it's a very difficult journey, and the government is, Karnataka is trying to ensure that we are right by your side in that journey and trying to see that you succeed. Like I said earlier, only if you succeed is when the government of Karnataka succeed. Thank you so much for having me on all the best.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Priyank Kharge. Big round of applause for our Honorable Minister for IT. Thank you very much, sir. I think it was very informative. Creating an environment which is conducive to growth, extreme proactiveness and support being extended to the entire ecosystem with programs like Elevate 100 and throwing open the grand challenge. You know, earlier today, Bala beautifully said to one of the questions, entrepreneurs should look at being a painkiller, not a vitamin. You know, I think like that you said, if we can solve bigger challenges, bigger problems, and be more disruptive, be unreasonable, I think that's why we are here as entrepreneurs. And I think Bangalore and Karnataka is really living up truly to the word of the Silicon Valley of Asia. Thank you very much for all your support. Really appreciate it. And I'm going to request you to stay on for a couple of questions. Hungry questions, maybe, but questions nevertheless, and then also request you to stay for a quick, we have picked a couple of startups who have been very innovative and disruptive, so sure. We're going to have you to really recognize them later on. So now for the questions.
I'm Mallikarjunaya from Agma Technologies. I already met Minister earlier in Elevate 100. We are into traffic automation. Sir told us that there is a grand challenge and all, we are going to participate. Sir, my question to you is, this is related to a central and a state government affair when it comes to a traffic. We are very much concerned.
When it comes to?
Policies. When it comes to policies. It is related to both central and the state government. When we develop a product or launch it, so how that will be, government is going to be addressed. For example, state government also has got some limitations, and central government also has to make a policy that has to be implemented in the state. So both government, we need to coordinate and make sure this product will be successful.
So, see, that's a little bit tricky because Although in the federal structure, we work with the central government, but the state government is free to have its own policy with respect to traffic. But if you're talking about some product that can be used by NHAI or SH, that is the State Highways or the National Highways Authority of India, the central government comes into play. But for policy formation, they do take opinion from every state government. So if you have a product or a service, that is, it depends on which part of traffic you're talking about, whether it's a city-based traffic or whether it's on the highways.
It is a city-based traffic.
So city-based traffic, the best thing would be to talk to the state governments, because more or less, most of them come under the state government's purview. But policy is something that we work in tandem, we work in sync with the central government.
So actually, some of the hardware is going to sit in the vehicle and that has to be monitored. So that definitely the policy changes are required from the government.
No, that's what. So I will have to understand your product better to help you out.
Okay.
Because although the Startup India policy is there and the central government has a lot of policies which are in consultation with the state government. Sometimes the reason why Karnataka is so ahead of the digital curve is because we have taken our own stand a lot of times, in the sense the state policies. So our example, our startup policy came up much before the stand-up policy, startup policy of India. So yeah, I'll have to really evaluate your product or service before I can give you any other suggestion.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Because today what semi-automated traffic violations are recorded and penalty collection is only 5%. I did a market survey.
So you're going to increase the revenues?
Definitely, sir. Definitely, 100%.
Then you should talk to state government.
Yes.
Next question, ma'am.
Hello, this is Vahini. I'm company secretary. Being a legal advisors or corporate compliance advisors to startup, I see most of the startups which we work with are not aware of these initiatives which is done by government, which is the right platform for them to know, because not everyone are good at social media, which is the right platform for them to know about government initiatives.
So even we are not very good at social media. The only people who are good at social media is the central government. So we believe in hard offline work as well. So you can always log on to the startup cell, and I agree with you, maybe not many startups are aware of this thing, because we need to propagate this a little more. But I'd like to assure you that out of the 7,200 startups that have been reported, 4,000 odd are already with the government of Karnataka. So I'm not sure if you are working with the right startups. but either ways, it's the startup cell that they need to approach. So you can just Google that, or karnataka.gov.in/startup cell. So that's where they can get all the information that you can require.
Okay. Maybe the small suggestion would be like, the government can take initiative to just give the awareness to the professional like CACS or CMA who works more with the startup. If they are aware, their clients automatically will be aware.
So we do have a lot of legal firms registered with us as well, who are who want to help startups. But it's again becomes a very tricky thing, because most of the startups are bootstrapped. So they might not be able to afford the huge fees that usually the legal entities charge. So we have spoken to a couple of legal entities, so that certain services that they give for startups are free, probably trademark advice, IP advice, and registration advices for company incorporations and all that. But anything above that, they can charge. So it is more on this thing. So if you're interested in empaneling with us, you can. I think Ashwin is there somewhere here. Is Mr. Ashwin around? Yeah, so he's from the startup cell. So he's my man Friday, so I carry him everywhere. So that offline questions can, he can help you out with how to register and how to empanel.
Very much. Thank you so much.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir. This is MV, but I am a proprietor of Notre Dame Corporation, and I am into medical equipment field. So ophthalmology equipment, I have around 20 years of experience. Right now, I could able to develop only one machine pertaining to ophthalmology. I have lots many big ideas, something like in my industry, for something like lasers, so many things, so many equipments which I handled. I have the know-how and all. But the approaching your department for the support need a paperwork. We need to talk to you only with the paperwork, you know, unless we have to put the things.
Have you
in
registered
the
with the startup cell?
Not yet.
Then how do you know this paperwork?
Pardon me?
How do you know there is paperwork, sir?
Actually, when I spoke to them, they told that you put a proposal in the paper so that you, then only you can do.
Recommend is that the idea of having the startup cell is so that you people don't have this big notion, you have that notion that government is not approachable.
Got
so
it.
In this startup cell, you have to give your company incorporation certificates, your legal entities,
okay.
And it's pretty much this thing. So they validate your legal status, and
yeah,
then you're registered.
Okay.
And I find it quite surprising that You have not, because 1,700 people applied for the Elevate 100. That validates how we deal with startups. Oh. And out of the 100 odd startups that we are talking about, more than 8 to 9 of them are from MedTech.
Okay.
So I'm not sure if you have actually seen the startup cell.
Sure, I'll approach personally. That would be better, I think.
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you for
hi,
your
I'm Avantika.
Yeah,
I
one last question.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. I run a graphic design company, and my question is coming in from the tourism perspective.
I'm sorry?
From the tourism perspective.
Tourism perspective.
I think public spaces and our museums and our monuments, there's a lot of lack of information there, and the upkeep of those places have been neglected for a really long period. Also, interestingly, new technology like AI, VR, etc. can come into those spaces. So I just wanted to know what the government would be doing.
So when was the last time you visited our state archaeology museum?
I actually helped to design the government, digitize the Bangalore government museum recently.
Which museum are you talking about?
The government museum on KG Road.
Yeah, so yeah. Digitize in the sense, what did you do?
Like we helped to redesign the signage and...
Along with?
Pinakin.
Pinaka.
Yeah.
So that's a startup that we funded.
Right.
So you did it because we did it. We allowed you to do it.
So I just wanted to know how we could do more of that.
So that was an experiment. Right. So anyway, I have a valid case here.
Yeah.
You validated my claim.
Right.
So both from tourism perspective as well as IT perspective. That so what we did was we called a call out for people who are trying to disrupt the tourism verticals, and I think. This is an audio-based guide, right? A geolocation-based audio guide. And before, when you used to go to our government museums or the government archaeology museum, which not many people know, you would just enter, probably walk around for 15, 20 minutes and get out, where you have 3,000, 4,000 years of history there, okay? But it was not curated at all. So when we called out, this particular startup came up, and we said, it seems good. Why don't you do it for us? So we have got the entire Kabban Park curated now. So with science museums, with archaeology museum, with AR, VR experiences. So you see Queen Victoria statue there, but you don't know why it is there. So we have put a nice yellow thing, which is again experimental, which is just going on. So you go stand there, and if you have that app, it'll actually tell you why the statue is there. It gives you a brief history of what it is, how it is doing. So we are trying to do that. And also we are trying to, from the tourism perspective, we are also trying to push people towards the museum. So for the first time, we had a museum tour, a consolidated museum tour of archaeology, science, arts in Chitrakala Parishat, and our Venkatappa Art Gallery, the Rorik Estate side. And I don't know how many people know that we also are the only one in the country who have a brain museum. So we tried curating that as well. But technology intervention is something that is it's a work in progress. So the first part of it is the Kabban circuit, which will be launching soonly, which will be launching soon. And like she said, she's worked with one of the startups that have been funded by us. So that's a validation of what I'm trying to say.
Very good. I think we are done for questions. But yeah, I mean, it's coming from the president of Picky Flow. You can definitely, I can't remember.
Minister, that was fabulous. Really proud to see the way Karnataka is progressing and supporting entrepreneurs. So I come from an organization called Fiki Ladies Organization. So we have a platform for women entrepreneurs. It's called Swayam. And right now I'm happy to say that our chapter has got about 18 mentees. And each of them are getting mentored and handheld, and you know, we have an expert panel as well that supports them as and when the need arises. So I just wanted to ask you, how is it possible for us to associate with the government and take advantage of all the programs that you have been promoting? Of course, we can do it offline, but I just wanted you to be aware that this is happening.
So for women entrepreneurs, right?
Yes, this is so only
probably,
women entrepreneurs.
We are the only state who has a special... please have a seat, ma'am. Have a special focus on women entrepreneurs, primarily because the government itself thinks in that direction, and more importantly, personally for me also, my director is a lady. My MD, KBITS, is a lady. So my principal secretary, the previous secretary, the additional chief secretary who headed ITBT, she was a lady. My Jilla Panchayat CEO in Gulbarga, she's a lady. My DC is a lady. So I'm always surrounded with women who keep guiding. So the first 25 years, it was my mother till I got married, then my wife, then my sisters, and my wife and everybody. So I take a lot of inspiration from all of you. And so that's why we have created a special fund for women of up to 10 crores for idea to POC. This thing, and more importantly, it is also a part of the government, and more importantly, like I said, even government, within the government, I have a lot of women guiding me, and outside the government, in the party also, I report only to Madam Sonia Gandhi. So if I don't do anything for women, I will be crucified by all these people. So we have a special focus for them, and also we would love to be a part of anything. And if you actually saw during our Elevate 100 program, we had a very special focus session for women, especially on what we could do for women entrepreneurs, how they can scale up. And it was just not limited to technology, a little bit of retail from tier two cities like Hubli, Mysuru, Mangaluru also were there. We had close to around 400 women entrepreneurs participate that day, and we had a very well curated session. And we had one very interesting topic over there, or two important topics over there. One was about failures, how to deal with failures when you're a woman entrepreneur and how difficult it is. I definitely know for firsthand how difficult it is for women to come out of their domestic lives to become an entrepreneur itself. And once you succeed, it is fine, but if you fail, then what? So we had a session on that. And the other important thing, which I think probably Fiki should also take a cue, and probably Fiki should also this thing, is reskilling women when they want to come back to work. So you take maternity leaves. So it's a gap of 1 year, 2 years, and you want to come back. And when you want to hit the circuit, you realize that the skill sets have changed. So how do we empower women who want to come back to work? So that also is a very important focus for us. So both women entrepreneurship and skilling women who are back also is a very key important area for us. And we'll be happy to collaborate with Fiki in any way possible.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.